Thank you for joining us this afternoon. This is Global Astronomy Month, and doing our part for that, NOVAC is hosting this Astronomy Day event. We've lined up some great speakers, and our next one is one of our special guest speakers. And this is Karl Battams. He is an astrophysicist and computational scientist based at the Naval Research Lab in Washington. Since joining NRL in 2003, Karl has led the NASA-funded SunGrazer Citizen Science Project that enables anyone in the world to discover new comets and solar satellite imagery. In 2013, Karl played a leading role in a global NASA campaign to observe the ill-fated comet Ison, and a similar role the following year as comet C-2013-S1 Sitting Spring buzzed close to Mars in October of 14. In addition to comet studies, Karl performs data analysis for the various space-based NRL solar and heliospheric physics branch projects with an emphasis on data and image processing and time series analysis. Outside of NRL, Karl is enthusiastic about public outreach.
Thank goodness.
And with public talks at the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum, TV documentaries, school STEM events, and via tweets as at SunGrazer Comets. So please welcome Karl Battams.
Good evening. Am I on? Okay. I'm Karl Battams from Naval Research Lab. As you just heard, I've been there for about 15 years now, so essentially my whole career at NRL. And pretty much that whole time, I've been working with now that guy up there, SOHO.
Yes, from the title, I'm not only talking about SOHO today, I'm talking about comets, because SOHO is history's greatest comet finder.
That's going to be kind of the main theme of this talk. There's sort of a secondary undercurrent to this talk, which is the role of amateur astronomers, because pretty much everything I'm going to talk about revolves around you guys, amateur astronomers, and the role of amateur astronomy. So there's going to be a couple of slides about that specifically at the end, but that's kind of an undercurrent for the whole thing. Before I get into the details about SOHO, some of you may be familiar with the mission, but before I get into those details, I'm going to start off talking about comets. Again, this may be information that a lot of you are familiar with, but it doesn't hurt to kind of bring everyone up to the same point. What are comets? The term dirty snowball has been used to describe comets. It's a little outdated term now, but basically a comet is a big old ball of frozen gases and dust and rock and stuff just kind of mushed together in this kind of loosely held together ball. They're not solid and dense like asteroids are. They're very kind of loosely packed, low density. And I've heard the term celestial dinosaur bones used. It's not my term, but I kind of like it. In kind of the same way that the dinosaur bones are sort of a clue to Earth's ancient past, comets are kind of a clue to our solar system's past. When we go back a few billion years, when our solar system is basically just a big old cloud of dust that's rotating around, at some point everything clumped together and started to form things like comets, and then all these things clumped together and formed planets. And one of the reasons we care about comets is because they're essentially a cosmic building block. They're an intermediate step between there being just dust in a solar system and there being planets and stars and all that good stuff that we got floating around now. And what's really key about comets, kind of unlike dinosaur bones, which are obviously fossilized, comets are pristine remnants of what made our solar system. So they're really the very building blocks more or less untouched from when we formed. And if you want to try and understand exactly how to form a planet, you first need to understand how to form a comet. And we're still not completely clear on how comets came together. So that's something that's sort of actively ongoing. And then this sort of last point about why we care about comets is that the source of life itself. I mean, we know at some point Earth was a big old hot mess with nothing going on, and then at some point in there, life kicked up. And at some point, Earth had a whole bunch of water delivered to it as well. For a long time, people thought, well, maybe comets were what delivered water to Earth. That view is leaning more towards asteroids being the delivery system for Earth's water. But I mean, there's no question that comets will have delivered some water to Earth. But more importantly, comets are this very complex mix of lots of different molecules. They've got things like amino acids in there and complex organics. And if you take an Earth that has no life on it, and then you bring in this big refrigerated ball that's got some amino acids and stuff in, and stick it in this hot soupy Earth, could you create life from that? I mean, I don't know. But it's one of the questions why we're kind of trying to understand what's going on with comets. And so, just to kind of remind people, this is kind of your classic comet image that we got going on here. Comet, we traditionally have two tails. There's actually sometimes more than two tails on a comet, but the simplistic view is these two tails. We got a dust tail that streams away, so this is big chunks of dust and ice that have come off from the comet. You've got what we call the ion tail, which is gas that's streaming away from the comet. And then when you get closer in, right at the center, we've got the nucleus. That's the solid part of all the rocks and the ices that have been mushed together. And then just surrounding that, we have the gas and dust coma. So that's just sort of this very, very fine atmosphere that surrounds the nucleus, full of gases that are released and very fine dust, kind of like the dust you'd find in a vacuum cleaner. Now, when we get from Earth, we can't see the core of comets because they're surrounded by all this dust. It blocks our view. So for a long time, we weren't really kind of sure what was going on in there close when you get in close. Now, thanks to Rosetta, which is a European Space Agency mission, a couple of years ago, they got close up to 67P. And this particular comet, at least, is this beautiful, almost alien landscape. It's a few kilometers across in diameter, so kind of average as comets go. But it's a stunning landscape with so many features that are going on. When you get up close to it, you see it's got features like these look like cliffs, and then all of this stuff looks like rubble that's kind of fallen down in like a slump, and then there's smooth plains, these boulders. This is just for context so you can get some size. This boulder down there is kind of like the size of your average two or three bedroom detached house. So kind of picture your house and it would sort of sit right there next to that rock. So you can kind of see that the comets are active at all scales. Like when you stand back, you see all the dust and the two tails. You get up close, there's still a lot of things that are going on. Now, this is sort of a view of your average vanilla comet. It's just a typical average comet. I'm talking about SOHO comets today, though. And I know some of you were probably at I gave a talk at George Mason to the NOVAC group last year where I talked about extreme comets. And the kind of comets that I'm talking about today with SOHO are what I would consider to be extreme comets. They're actually what we call sun-grazing comets. And sun-grazing comets are supersonic snowballs in hell. They are really their own class of comet in terms of behavior, their physics. They're really, truly bizarre and fascinating, to me at least. First of all, the name, sun-grazing comets. We call them sun-grazing comets because these are comets that go ridiculously close to the sun. So ridiculously close that they're basically grazing the atmosphere of the sun, so we call them sun grazers. This is probably my favorite fact about sun grazers of all. One of the cool things about sun grazing comets, because they get so close to the sun, and because the sun is so massive, they go really, really, really fast. They're getting up to velocities around 600 kilometers a second, 0.2% of the speed of light. So we're talking of objects kind of the size of a house that are going pretty much from here to somewhere just beyond Pittsburgh in about 1 second. Like, it's an insane, it's sort of incomprehensible almost, the velocities that these things achieve. And because they get so close to the sun, for those of you that appreciate magnitude scales, in the matter of 2 or 3 days, they can brighten up in order of like 20 magnitudes in 2 or 3 days, which, I mean, normally astronomers get excited if a comet has an outburst of 2 or 3 magnitudes. It's like, woo, like, throw your hats in the air, it's exciting. These things go up 20 magnitudes in a few days. So it's a massive increase in brightness. But unfortunately, the vast, vast majority of them do not survive going past the sun because they go so close. Real quick, I want to talk about the image that's in the background just very briefly. This is an image from the Hinode satellite, Japanese Space Agency. That's the edge of the sun. You can imagine the sun in this image must be, like, it's huge. There's a sun-grazing comet right down there. This is that's Comet Lovejoy in 2011. This is one of the coolest images that that I've ever seen, where we'd get this little kind of David and Goliath thing going on. So let's talk about visual observations first before we get into satellite stuff. So sun-grazing comets have been seen for a few centuries now. But really, the history of them, the vast majority of sun-grazing comets belong to this group we call a Kreutz group. And the history there is that in the late 1800s, there was a German astronomer called Heinrich Kreutz, and he was kind of sitting down looking at some looking at data regarding some comets that had been seen in the 1843, 1880, 1882. These were really bright comets that were seen really close to the sun, pretty much seen in broad daylight, and he was thinking, well, these comets, they seem to be on the same path, but they can't be the same comet. Like, there's no way it could be the same thing coming by the sun over and over again. And so he did the math, and he basically figured out that what was going on is these three comets shared an orbit in space, so they shared the same path through space. And they were obviously related to a parent comet, but they weren't the same thing. And so, essentially, we know this as the Kreutz group of comets. And essentially what's happened is, some number of millennia ago, we don't know how long ago, there was a big comet that went by the sun. For various reasons, that comet fell apart, continued on its merry way into space, came back a few hundred years later, those chunks, they fell apart again, they continue on their way, you rinse and repeat a few times, and you end up with this big long trail of essentially rubble through space, these smaller objects. And that's what the SOHO comets are that I'm going to be talking about. But in terms of ground observations, I'm not going to point anybody out, but there may be people in the room that remember Ikiyoseki in 1965. That was a bright daylight comet. And then 2011, we had Lovejoy, which was another fantastic comet. But again, Ikiyoseki was ground-based. Lovejoy was discovered from the ground. So by 1979, there were around about a dozen, I think there's one, I say around about a dozen because there's one or two comets that we weren't sure if they're sun grazers or not, but around about a dozen of these Kreutz group comets that were on record. So it's a healthy number of comets. But then everything kind of changed in 1979, and this next thing I think is one of the critical moments in like modern space history that people don't ever pick up on. And I like to emphasize it. This is 79. A bunch of solar physicists that I work with or have worked with, they had a satellite, Air Force satellite that was doing some Air Force things, and they had it looking at the sun as well. And they got their images back one day, and they were looking, and there was this big old bright streak in their images. And so their initial reaction is like, oh crap, like the instrument, something's gone wrong. This shouldn't be there. And they scratched their heads for a while, and eventually they realized that this bright streak in the images, and this is the actual actual data from the satellite, they were like, it must be a comet. And it turns out it was a sun-grazing comet, and it made the cover of Science magazine. But this is actually a really pivotal moment that people don't appreciate. This is the very first time that any solar system object was discovered from space. Until then, asteroids, comets, planets, whatever, everything had been ground-based discovery. Now we routinely discover asteroids and comets and planets in the far reaches of the galaxy we're detecting those from space all the time. But this was the very first moment that something had been discovered in space. It's kind of a pivotal moment. And so Solwind went on to discover 9 new comets until it was decommissioned in 1985. And then there was a follow-on mission called SMM that found a few more comets after that. And so basically, kind of getting a little bit more up to date, by 1990 there were around 30 of these Kreutz group comets on record. So in 79 we had about 12, by 20 years or so later there were 30, so things were looking good for that group. Then comes the hero of our story, then comes SOHO. Okay, Solar and Heliospheric Observatory. It is a joint ESA-NASA mission launched in December 1995. So we're into our 23rd year of the mission. And it's positioned at the L1 Lagrange point in space. And this solar system diagram in the background, basically you've got Earth here, the Sun over here. L1 is kind of roughly where that red star is. So basically SOHO sits just in front of the Earth, and as Earth goes around the Sun, SOHO does as well. So SOHO is always looking at the Sun. It has this perfectly uninterrupted view of the Sun. SOHO it's got more than a dozen instruments on it, and the key point here is SOHO was designed to study the Sun and the Sun's atmosphere. And just the Sun. SOHO was not designed to look for comets, it was not designed to see comets, it was not designed to find comets. There was no comet consideration with SOHO. It is just about the Sun. But nonetheless, it's very successful with comets. It is still operating today. They've turned off a lot of the instruments. Thankfully, our instrument, which is LASCO, which I'm going to talk about next, that's one of two instruments really that's still operating on SOHO. All of the others have kind of been superseded by other missions that have launched since then. So on SOHO we have LASCO, which is a large angle spectrometric coronagraph. LASCO is a pair of coronagraph telescopes. Some of you may have heard of coronagraph telescopes. Essentially, a coronagraph is a telescope that looks directly at the Sun, but because the Sun is so blindingly bright, these telescopes have a solid disk in the middle, and that solid disk kind of blocks out that blinding light, so you can see all the good stuff that's going on around the Sun without getting blinded by the Sun. So these are the two cameras we have, the two LASCO cameras we have, C2 and C3. The Sun is the size of that little white disc there, and then the solid disc is what's blocking the Sun out, and so we've got the inner field of view there, and then the C3 is a wider field of view, so the Sun is a bit smaller in this one. This happens to be a coronal mass ejection that's blasting off on these images. And then in the background we see stars and stuff, and because of the nature of this solid disc, because we're blocking this blinding light, fairly faint stuff near the Sun, and we're talking down to like magnitude 8 or so, for those of you again that appreciate the magnitude scale, so it's not like super faint, but it's pretty good. It's certainly good enough for a lot of comets. Now, just before we really get into the meat of this with the comets, I just want to like lower the expectations of the tent here, because you might be thinking, wow, like SOHO's seeing all these comets, like it must be amazing. If this is your expectation, I'm afraid this is the reality. SOHO's comets are not the prettiest of comets. They're not exactly big, beautiful, photogenic things. The beauty of SOHO's comets is in the details in the science, I think. Mostly they are tiny, tiny little dots that make you go cross-eyed and squint at like noise in the images. So they're not photogenic, but there are lots of them. And when I say lots of them, it really is a lot. So reminding you, 1979 we had around a dozen comets. By 1990 we had around 30 comets. As of a couple of weeks ago, we had 3,511 comets. SOHO's pretty good at finding comets. Just for context, in total there's around 6,000 comets on record, including the 3,500 that we have from SOHO. So we're well over half of all comets. Just to give you an idea of what we look like, these are actually kind of brighter examples. You see a small one just going in there. There's a slightly brighter one. That's actually a really impressively bright one for SOHO. There's a pair of them just a few hours later. In this image over here, there's just one comet in this movie. You see that guy going in there. Now, you see in that image, it looks like just this thin streak. It's not like this big thing with this big old bushy tail or whatever. The reason it's this thin streak is because actually by the time you see it in there, I wouldn't even call that a comet anymore. It's basically just a debris trail. That's an object that will have crumbled apart some hours before it entered this field of view, and it's just this long stream of rubble that's getting vaporized as it goes in. But that's where we are with SOHO. 3,511 comets, and the key to SOHO's success is citizen science, amateur astronomers. And it's through this SunGrazer project that I've been running at NRL on behalf of NASA for all of these years. SunGrazer project is a citizen science project that allows anyone in the world, as long as you've got a comfy chair and a lot of patience and an internet connection, you can sit there, you can download the latest images from SOHO. It returns a lot of data in real time. You look through the images, you look for little comets. Comets get reported to our website, and then it's my job to look through all of the reports and then decide if something's really a comet or if it's just noise or stars or whatever. And then once I've figured out what comets are real, I number them, and then I do all the sciencey measurements so that we can get the orbits and stuff for the comets. It's basically simple in principle. It's not a complex setup at all. And obviously very successful, but it really is down to amateur astronomers. There's around 97-98 individual people that have got their names attached to SOHO comets. There's a small number of people on the SOHO mission team. Like myself, I don't consider myself an amateur astronomer in this context. I think I found 20 or some of the comets, but the vast majority have come from amateur astronomers. We're talking like school teachers, college students. There's been a couple of 13-year-olds that have found comets. Like, people from all walks of life that have just got interest in this have found these comets. Now, I could get really deep into some very boring numbers about the comets, but this is about as numbery as I'm going to get on this. But I just want to give you an idea of how the SOHO comets break down, because they're not all sun-grazing comets. Of our 3,500 comets, around just over 3,000 of them now belong to this Kreutz group that I was telling you about, that the Heinrich Kreutz figured out in the 1800s. So that's 86% of them. That's a good chunk of them. But around 6% belong to this group called the Maya group. Maya group is a family of objects that was not known until SOHO started discovering them. We've only ever seen them with SOHO. We don't know if they're truly comets or if they're more like asteroids. We don't know how big they are. We don't know where they come from. We don't know where they're going. We don't know if they're short period or long period. We know basically nothing about them except they exist, and we've seen 225 of them. But they're very cool. 96P family. I've got a couple of slides about 96P coming up later, because it's a really fascinating object. But we got around 3% of those, and then the rest are what we call non-group objects. Non-group comets are basically just sporadic, random objects that come from who knows where, going off who knows where. They're not sort of seemingly related to anything else. But that's sort of how the numbers break down in the project. But It's kind of hard to convey this many comets just by putting a bunch of numbers up. So what I love to do, rather than put numbers up to tell you about the comets, is to actually show you the comets. So here, I hope that we can see it. You can see it reasonably well. Here you are going to see the first 2,000 of SOHO's 3,500 comets. This is a visualization of the actual orbits of SOHO comets for 1996 through 2010. You've got 2,000 objects in. The different colors relate to those different families that I was just telling you a minute ago. So this movie is from the perspective of a imaginary spacecraft that just kind of gently gliding around the solar system. And you'll see that, primarily These red ones, obviously, is that Kreutz group that I was telling you. There's, where are the Maya group comets? Oh, yeah, so the Maya group comets are coming in, like, here. You'll see in a minute, like, the cloud of Kreutz comets is, particularly if you watch this in a dark room, it's really staggering to appreciate this massive object that's coming in. And what I like to people to think about while they're watching this animation, because it goes on for a minute or so, if it wasn't for SOHO, and if it wasn't for amateur astronomers looking through the SOHO images, this would be a really boring 2 minutes, because you'd basically be looking at planets just flying around. Like, this animation that's got all this stuff going on would be almost completely empty if it wasn't for what SOHO has done in combination with these amateur astronomers. And it's just a phenomenal number of comets. It's a phenomenal wealth of science. And what I'm going to talk about next, once this animation ends, I'm going to get into just a little bit of the science that comes with these, because, I mean, as I'm sure you can imagine, this stuff is rich with science. It's this is my favorite part. There's so many comets coming in right there. There's so much science that we can get out of these, even though they're only seen by SOHO, which was not designed to see them, it was not designed to discover them. The images are not perfect for looking at comets. Nonetheless, through looking at these sun-grazing comets and the various families that are in there, we get a huge amount of information about the behavior of objects near the sun, how comets fragment, how their orbits evolve, all these processes that are going on when you get near the sun. In addition to learning about comets, I don't get into it in this talk at all, but we also learn a lot about the sun as well, because these comets are essentially probing the near sun atmosphere. So there's a wealth of science that comes into this stuff. And so I'm going to start with this, the Heartbreaker, Comet Ison. I assume Comet Ison is familiar to a few people in the room. It's the astronomers in the room will remember. A few years ago, there was a very bright comet that was discovered, or it became very bright. It was a sun-grazing comet that was discovered like a year before it was going to reach the sun. And everyone got like super, super excited, because they were like, well, when this thing gets by the sun, it's going to be brighter than the full moon, and we're going to be dancing in the streets, and it's going to be fantastic. And of course, it was a sun-grazing comet, and it did exactly what sun-grazing comets do, which means it basically got destroyed by the sun when it went near the sun. But Ison is like the poster child for sun-grazing comet behavior. And even though SOHO didn't discover this one, the science that we got from Ison is basically completely applicable to everything we get from the SOHO comets. So, for example, we like to follow the brightness of comets. Comets get brighter when they get closer to the sun. It's their activity that dictates their brightness. The closer they are to the sun, the more solar radiation they're receiving. So the more active they are, the brighter they are. So one of the most basic things we can do with the SOHO images is record the brightness of the comets. And I'm not gonna get too into the details of this plot. Don't worry about the colors. But the point here is, like, we have distance from the sun, and this dashed line represents the sun. And as the comet gets closer to the sun, it gets brighter and brighter. Now, with Ison, before it reached the sun, it started getting fainter again. And when we saw that, we knew at that point that was really bad news for this comet, because it was supposed to still be getting brighter as it got closer to the sun. If it starts getting fainter, that means it's run out of material. So we knew the comet was exhausted and dying at that point. But just by watching the brightness, how the brightness changes, we already get to learn information about the comet. I'm sure you've been watching this animation of Ison as it's been going by the sun, and you will have seen that. They're looking for me. They can't see me in here.
You're giving away the secret.
I know. If there's a navy on the side, I'm under the table.
You're talking about comets, Freddy.
Okay, so you've been watching this movie of Comet Ison coming in. You may have noticed that as it comes into the field of view, the shape of the comet's tail, it's very kind of sharp and like pointy and needle-like, and then it goes by the sun, and then afterwards it's got a very different shape. It gets dusty and diffuse. Now that shape, like down here, a friend of mine, Grant Jones, he did some modeling of the dust tail of the comet. We can do these computer models of the dust, and using that we can tell how big the different dust grain sizes are in relation to where the comet is. We can tell when the dust was released from the comet. We can, and basically from that information, we can get an idea of when the comet stopped producing dust. So there's a ton of information we can get just from looking at the shape of the tails as well. Now, I had mentioned briefly earlier the 96P family. I know we all like to think that we've got weird and complicated families, but I would argue that the 96P family has got to be one of the most complicated families in the solar system. This thing is weird. So, 96P Macholtz, it was found in 1986 by Don Macholtz, another amateur astronomer, a particularly successful one, but another amateur astronomer. It's been one of the most regular visitors to the SOHO cameras. We've seen it 5 times now, most recently last year. It's on a 5 or so year orbit around the solar system, and it's got a perihelion distance, that means its closest point to the sun is around 0.12 astronomical units, so it's like about 10 million miles or so from the sun, which sounds a long way. If you were 10 million miles from the sun, you wouldn't be happy. It's really, really close to the sun. And the other extent of its orbit is just outside of Jupiter's orbit. It actually goes very close to kind of the path that Jupiter follows in space. It actually goes really very close to Jupiter's path. And one of the first, just a weird quirk of this comet is that it's going around the solar system every 5 years. So every 5 years it's going out to where Jupiter hangs out, and Jupiter's going around doing its own thing. And you would think that it's going out to where Jupiter is and Jupiter's going around, at some point the two would get close to each other and Jupiter would do what it does and fling it off into a different orbit or whatever. One of the weird things about 96P is if you trace its orbit back in time, you go back 5, 10, 50, 100, 300, 500, 1,000, you go back 2,000 years of these 5-year orbits, it's never come anywhere near Jupiter, even though it's always crossing close to Jupiter's orbit. It's just a weird quirk of its orbit. It should really have been flung off somewhere else by now. It's managed to avoid that. 96P is seen a lot from the ground. We do observe it. One of the reasons people observe it a lot is because it has a weird, weird composition. It's one of the most, even though it kind of waddles and quacks just like your average comet, it looks like a normal comet, but its composition, just as an example, it is CN, which is, I put cyanide in parentheses, it's actually cyanogen, but it's related to cyanide. It's one of the most common molecules in comets, oddly enough, so don't go licking any comets anytime soon. But 96P is 72 times more deficient in CN than the next CN abundant comet. And there's a bunch of other stuff that it's really weirdly depleted into. Is that a consequence of going close to the sun for 2,000 years? We really don't know, but the composition of 96P is very, very bizarre. But above all of that, 96P has a bunch of children, a lot of children, and I'm going to go down a list here. So 96P, it is the parent of, first of all, 2 SOHO comet groups. What I mean by that is, within SOHO's 96P family, there are 2 separate families of their own of comets, of about 50 or so comets in each family. And those families have their own orbits that are separate from each other and separate from 96P's orbit, but they're all related to 96P. Like, we know they came from 96P. So it's got these 100 or so, 2 other little families that are floating around. So that's the first quirk. Secondly, if you heard in the last meteor, the last talk, it was mentioned how meteor showers are essentially the debris left by a comet. So you get a big comet go through space and it leaves this long trail of dust. And when Earth goes through that dust, we get meteor showers like the Leonids and all that stuff. So comets often have like these meteor trails. That's good. 96P has three meteor showers at Earth. Not one, but three. It's got Quadrantes, Delta Aquarids, Daytime Aratids. That's really unusual for a comet to have three meteor showers. So we've got two groups with a bunch of comets, and it's got three meteor showers. Recently, we found out there's three small fragments next to it. These were discovered in the SOHO images. We saw 96P in 2012, and there were two little comets leading the main body as it was going through the images, and we were like, well, that's new, but okay. And then 2017, it comes back again. There was a third one, so we got the main body of 96P and it traveled up through the images, and there was a fragment there, fragment there, fragment there. And I was looking at the images, I think there might actually be some others tucked in there that are really hard to pick out, but for some reason it really likes dropping chunks, and we don't know why it does this. It also has a spuriously random SOHO comet, some comet that didn't appear to be related to anything at all, but when you do the math, it turns out it's kind of related to 96P, but probably a very long time ago it's related to it. And then finally, just to top it all off, just to add to the weirdness, there's an asteroid, 2003 EH1, not absolutely 100% definitively linked to that comet, but it's really, really likely that somehow that asteroid has got something to do with that comet. So we've got a couple of groups with 100 comets, we've got three meteor showers, we've got a bunch of fragments, we've got a random thing, we've got an asteroid, and we really have no idea what's going on with this comet. It's got a weird composition, it seems to hate Jupiter, and the point about this, aside from 96P being a really fascinating object, is, again, so much of this is due to amateur astronomers reporting or finding this stuff. These groups have only been seen by SOHO. We'd have no idea that they existed if it wasn't for what SOHO has done. Okay, one last cool object I want to tell you about. In 99, in LASCO C2, there was a little asteroidal, little bright point of light that was found. We assumed it was a comet because it kind of brightened up like comets do, and we ended up seeing it a bunch of times. Turned out to be a short period object that got designated 322P. Should return next year, actually, I think. Maybe even late this year. It had no tail, no coma, it didn't look like a comet, but it got much brighter as it got near the sun, which meant it kind of had to be a comet, because if it was an asteroid, it would have to be like a huge, small planet-sized asteroid for it to bright up that way, and we know that for various reasons it couldn't have been that. So it had to be a comet, because it was getting active near the sun, but it was kind of weird looking, as a lot of SOHO's objects are. In 2015, my friend Matthew Knight, he led a team that used a bunch of ground-based telescopes, and they managed to see this thing from the ground. It's pretty much as spectacular from the ground as it was from SOHO, but that's fine. They detected no cometary activity. They figured out it's around 150 to 320 meters in diameter, and basically they concluded it seems to be asteroidal in origin, but it gets active when it gets close to the sun, and that's because its surface temperature goes up to around 1,000 degrees. If you basically take your favorite cozy armchair at home and throw it up next to the sun and get up to 1,000 degrees, it's going to look like a comet. Like, your armchair is going to vaporize and have dust and stuff. So that's kind of what's going on with these things. And the point here is that it leads to the question, well, what is a comet versus an asteroid? Like, typically we define it by activity, physical activity, but when you take an asteroid and put it really close to the sun, it has activity. Like, stuff starts, albeit rock, stuff starts boiling off. So it's kind of leading us to question, do we need to redefine, or how do we want to define these things? Because objects like this they really make us readdress the categories that we had we'd come up with in the past. And once again, this is entirely an amateur astronomy driven thing. So for the last couple of slides, as I said, there was this whole talk has got this undercurrent of amateur astronomy about it. And here's something that I don't see people mention enough. These are just a couple of screenshots I grabbed from the web, but in recent decades there is a wealth of professional grade telescopes and optics and cameras and filters and lenses, all this stuff that you go back 50 years ago, that was just the domain of astronomers, like professional astronomers in universities that had this equipment. Now it's kind of generally, depend on your opinion, within the budgetary reach of your average hobbyist. I mean, some would argue about stretching the budget, but it's generally within the reach. And what we've got now is there is more what I'd call pseudo-professional eyes on the sky than at any point in human history. And that needs to be taken advantage of. And I think, to a point, we are beginning to do that. There are groups of astronomers, professionals, that are realizing that you guys, with your really amazing telescope setups that are taking these images, it's great that you're doing that. Let's share that science. Like, you're actually getting science, whether you realize it or not. There's some valuable stuff in there. So, as was mentioned in my little bio at the beginning, I was involved in this thing called SEOC. It was originally Comet Ice on Observing Campaign. Then we morphed the name to be about just integrating observations of comets. We did this global thing related to first Comet Ice on and then Comet Sighting Spring, where we were basically saying, we've got these comets coming in. They're going to be fascinating. Something cool is going to happen. You guys have got amazing equipment. Send us your images. Whatever you get, just send us your stuff. We'll figure it out. Like, we want to do as much science as we can. Like, if everyone around the world is watching this thing, we can have almost 24-hour coverage on these comets. And so that's what happened. And it was tremendously successful. Like, science papers have come out from that. Rosetta with their 67P that took those beautiful images of the comet that I showed you at the beginning, they had a similar thing where they wanted to get all of these amateur observations of the comet and combine them and do science with them, and they did it. And then Padma Yanamandra Fisher, she runs it's kind of a Facebook based thing now, the Pro-Am Collaborative Astronomy Project, and she does a lot of kind of smaller scale versions of this. So her website or that Facebook page sort of keeps people appraised of when there's a comet coming in that's interesting and tries to gather groups of amateur astronomers together to get observations and try and get science out of it. And the point is that the bottom line that I have for pretty much this whole talk is that amateur astronomers can make a significant scientific impact, and they do make a scientific impact. And particularly now that amateur astronomers have got their hands on professional grade equipment, whether it's the professional grade stuff that you guys have got out in the field right now, or when amateur astronomers get their hands on SOHO satellite data, the point is amateur astronomers and professional equipment ends up with a big impact. That's what happens when you put professional equipment in the hands of amateur astronomers. And I will be happy to take any questions. Yeah.
So when you mentioned that this many asteroids have been detected, it means that you're able to catalog and differentiate between them. Right?
Yes. Yes.
Or is it the fact that they're getting destroyed that you know you're not seeing them again?
It's both of those things. I mean, obviously, because they're getting destroyed, we know we're not seeing them again. Actually, some of the... So the 67P family that I was talking about, the two subgroups within those, they are short-period objects. And in some cases, there will be comets that have come back after sort of 4 or 5 years, and we're not entirely sure if it's the same one or not. So... there's a very small fudge factor in those numbers, but it's a very small fluctuation. For the vast majority of the objects, yes, they're getting destroyed, so we know that it hasn't been there before, but we also know that they belong to the Kreutz group, so we know how they behave. Like, we know that, that they're all distinct, unique objects. Yeah.
So the one quasi-asteroid, or whatever it is, mm-hmm. that, you count that as the first discovery of the theoretical Vulcans?
Yeah, no, so there's Vulcans, yeah, there's always been this talk of, was there like this big planet or something that's destroyed, is there this population of asteroids near the sun that we've been seeing before? No, we wouldn't classify this thing as, I don't think we'd include it in a conversation about Vulcans at all. This is just what seems to be probably the shortest perihelion distance asteroid we have on record. This just happens to be the closest asteroid to the sun that we know of. The Minor Planet Center hasn't officially recognized it as an asteroid, unfortunately, partly because they don't know how to define it, because it gets near the sun and its surface starts outgassing, so they're like, well, that's what comets do, but we know it's an asteroid when it's over there, but it's a comet over there, so we don't know what we're going to do, so we'll just leave it alone.
So it's probably a carbonaceous
comet. It is a weird creature, and its colors are slightly different too, from the photometric standpoint, the science standpoint. I forget what the specifics of the paper were, but it has slightly odd colors for being an asteroid, but we don't know what an asteroid is supposed to look like when it's been roasted to death every few years for however many thousands of years. We don't know what happens when you do that to a lump of rock. Like, you can't even simulate that on Earth. We have no idea what this thing should look like.
Yep. One thing you mentioned is that most of the comets are similar in composition, so is there sort of a range or a categorizing of them, or are they all pretty much just in one big bucket?
It's all in one big bucket. If I implied similar in composition, what I should have said is we're assuming that they're all of a similar composition, because we can't really differentiate their composition based on the SOHO images. One of the drawbacks of SOHO, as I said at the beginning, it wasn't designed to do any of what we're doing with it. Like, this number was never supposed to be there. These images were not made for that, so we're kind of doing the best we can with what we've got, and composition is one of the things that we can do very, very little about with these comets, unfortunately.
But overall, with cometary composition, is there sort of a categorization, and if there isn't, is there a theory that they're almost all from one origin?
No, I mean, we know that comets that formed in different parts of the okay. solar system are slightly different, so we don't try to, if we don't specifically have a spectroscopy that tells us about some of the composition, then we don't make any assumptions about the composition. We just say, we don't know what this thing is composed of, other than it's a ball of rock and ice. That's...
Okay.
Okay.
Is there a future coronagraph mission where you can kind of work with them to spec optimizing it for comets?
I would like to. It's we definitely have future coronagraph missions in the works, but coronagraph missions are very much focused on coronal mass ejections and space weather prediction. It's going to be difficult. The optics of the system, getting a telescope. Chronographs are very, very complicated to design. It seems like it's simple, like I've got that light shining at me now, I block it and I'm good. I can see you all, I take it away, I don't see quite as well. That's not how it works in space. Like, the brightness of the sun in space is truly indescribably insanely bright, and so the work that goes into the optics, like I've seen our telescopes on the benches at work, the stuff that goes into it, it is insanely complicated. So they have this big field of view, which helps. If you want to try and get down to the spectroscopy of these comets using a coronagraph, you've got a really high power telescope, you've got, it just makes things so much more complicated. So I'm not saying that one day there won't be something, but that would come from probably a very generous NASA pocket at that point. I don't anticipate a NASA pocket being that generous anytime soon.
Would a spacecraft like that, that's focused on, well, I guess any meteorites, meteors, would that have to be a high slew rate, narrow field?
Yeah, I mean, the SOHO comets, I mean, particularly if it's, if we could design this magical telescope we're talking about, if the sun wasn't a problem, we could follow these things with a very powerful telescope. Yeah, it would probably have to shift pretty fast. I mean, they cover several degrees in just a few days. I mean, that 600 kilometers per second that I was talking about, that's only when they're very close to the sun. But even still, you go a couple of days before they're at the sun, and they're still cutting along at 50-100 kilometers per second. That's an object that's moving really, fast. So tracking those things would be another challenge.
Of course, you don't require it.
And then you've got to acquire it, and we don't know when these things are coming along. And one of the issues, particularly with the sun grazers, is when I said they brighten by like 20 magnitudes, when they're coming into the solar system 3 or 4 days before they're near the sun, we think they're down at like magnitude 24. So you need to find something down at magnitude 24. I'm sure some of you could appreciate how hard that would be to find something at magnitude 24, and then track it as it goes up to being magnitude 3 in the space of a few days while traveling at a few hundred kilometers per second. It's not a trivial challenge.
Thank you, Carl.
Yeah, thank you.